worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened, worshipless Buddha, consummated in knowledge and behavior. How is a bhikkhu moderating eating? While reflecting rationally, he eats food neither for the sake of entertainment, nor of infatuation, nor wishing for bodily beauty, but exclusively for the support and maintenance of this body, for ending discomfort, and for assisting this noble life, considering, thus will I now end this old feeling of hunger, yet without arousing any new feeling of greed. Thus will I remain healthy, blameless, and in comfort, exactly as one treats an open wound, only for the purpose of healing it, or as one greases an axle only for the sake of easy transport of a heavy load. So does a bhikkhu who is moderated in eating while always reflecting rationally eat food. Thank you.
Yes, hello to you again, friends. This is just an out in nature, a small thing here up on the mountain. As you see, a small note about priorities seen from a Buddhist perspective. And I've taken up this what matters issue from one of my former colleagues in Burma, Mingun, Sayadaw. He had a prominent role in the Sixth Council in 1956, which you see here, where the Tipitaka text was recited once again. But I found some very pithy, short, and very instructive words of him on the internet via another Burmese friend of ours, Buddhist friend. So I thought I would share with you with him, huh? First, he says, it doesn't matter whether being physically beautiful or not. Doesn't matter. It does matter to be kind-hearted. So there is this Buddhist concept of a kalyanamitta. A kalyanamitta basically means a beautiful friend. When we say a beautiful friend, then we don't mean a friend that is has a beautiful body or face or body form or whatever. We mean a spiritual friend that is have a kind heart, a gentle heart, and one who is a helper, who functions as a spiritual mother for others and help them on their spiritual path, which often not is that easy. So a kalyanamitta is a beautiful friend with a beautiful mind, not with a beautiful body, necessarily. What is a beautiful versus an ugly body sign off from the past? Yeah, a beautiful facial expression, especially a beautiful mouth, is a signifies that one in the past has been talking a lot of kind words. And when scolded, when criticized, one has not been backbiting. So this gives this beautiful facial expression. Giving food to monks and to nobles and to good people in general and to the poor, this gives a strong body. And giving clothes that beautifies the body, or ointments, or salve, or whatever in that direction that enhances the bodily appearance. This gives bodily beauty in the future. Basically, what you give is what you get, neither more nor less. Then he says, it doesn't matter whether having a fair complexion or not. It does matter to have a pure morality. Again, you can see very beautiful people with very fair complexions, and they have a sila, a morality, an ethical standard that is horrible. And so they will quickly fall from their high state. So the beautiful liar, the beautiful stealer, the beautiful sexual abuser, they quickly fall from their high state. And in the next life they will not become beautiful, they will become ugly. Because they have committed these ethical transgressions, this overstepping of the nature's rules of what is harmonious and what is disharmonious, and thereby probabilistically polluted their own future. Then he says, it doesn't matter whether being rich or not, it does matter to possess a content mind. Doesn't matter to be rich or not. What it does matter is to be content with what you have, whatever little you have. When can one be content? If one has a roof over the head, clothes on the body, food in the mouth and medicine when sick, then one can be content in whatever amount this comes. We are admonished by the Buddha to live under a tree, us monks, but he allowed we lived in a small bhavanakuti or in a temple. He allowed that. But he said progress was faster if you live under a tree. So it doesn't take much to be content. However, it's very, very common to see, also for me, when I communicate with people abroad, families that has 3 cars, and live in a 200 square meter house, they're still very discontent. Still they blame others that they don't have more than that. So this is very common to see. People who are fairly rich have a lot of material wealth, but they're very unhappy and very discontent. Why is that so? Because contentment, santuti, is caused not by material richness, but by rejoicing in others' success, mudita. Rejoicing in others' success, the opposite of envy and jealousy. So if habitually envious and jealous, and even though exorbitantly rich, then one will still be discontent, because one has provided the cause for being discontent, namely jealousy and envy. While if even poor, with only one piece of cloth, if one is rejoicing in all others' possessions and success, then one will be content even with very little, maybe even with nothing. So is it. It doesn't matter whether anyone is good or bad. It does matter whether you are good. And that's of course true. One can see a lot of people discussing in family conflicts and in all kinds of conflicts in politics. They see constantly this blaming finger. The other one is a wrongdoer. The other one did this and that wrong, and now I'm hurt and they should be punished and so on. But every time this blaming finger is forward, coming forward, one should know that there's 3 fingers pointing back to oneself. And that's what matters. What the others do intentionally, what probabilities they form, it will never affect your future. So it's whether you are good or bad. That forms your future. So whether others are good or bad, it is completely irrelevant. And I would say even more than irrelevant, it's detrimental, because it's a wrong direction of mind to go around and blame others, this and that. One should use a mirror and look at oneself and see what there is of mental defilements. And if there is blaming, then one can start with this mental defilement in the form of blaming. When stopping blaming and forgiving And getting this forbearance, this tolerance, this patience, kanti, with others, as well as with oneself, then a lot of emotional disturbance and unhappiness caused by this blaming all the wrongdoers out there in the world that is making me unhappy. No. There's nobody making you unhappy except yourself and your own mental defilements. Look at them. Look at own jealousy. Look at own lack of rejoicing in another's success. Look at own laziness. Instead of pointing out the other's inefficacy at work or whatever. That's skillful. Skillful driving. It works. And you, if you want to improve others, then improve yourself. Then you become a very good example. They will follow you by the hundreds, by the thousands, when you improve yourself thoroughly. Because it will come out, you don't need to say it, it will come out through your behavior, through your thinking, and also through your verbal activities. It will come out automatically. So when one is improving oneself by Dhamma study, like these videos, reading the texts, the Tipitaka text, and by meditation, then one is not only improving oneself, one is improving the entire world. And that's the only way to improve the entire world. Revolutions don't work. Usually a lot of people get killed and imprisoned, and it's a horrible thing. I was a revolutionary myself as a youngster, but after having seen several revolutions crash, among others Khmer Rouge in Cambodia, and the whole Eastern Bloc, and also China collapsing, then I gave up my thought in this socialist revolutionary idea, which is too short because it doesn't take into account the mental defilement of each individual. So there just comes a new set of socialist dictators, and then they will dictate the terms, and nobody will be happy from that. But if everybody cleans their mind, accept what is advantageous, and avoid what is evil and detrimental, then the Buddha said it will be like this, that we can sleep with the doors open, and we will dance with the children in our arms. That's the end result of a fully completed Buddhist society of human beings. They dance with the children in their arms, and they can sleep with the doors open. That's a very nice image to give forward, I think. It doesn't matter whether being happy with sensual pleasures or not. It does matter to be happy with contemplation of the Dhamma. And that's true. That's also true. Whether this or that taste, or this or that video, or this or that film, or this or that sexual encounter, or this or that house you're building or construction, or whether this or that smell, sight, taste, touch, or mental state that is pleasurable or not, it just comes and goes eventually anyway. Huh? It will always end. A moment of sense pleasure lasts only one moment of sense pleasure. So how to be content with that? But to be content with the Dhamma is something very subtle, and something I'm experiencing in larger and larger amounts and doses as long as I'm living the noble life down here on this mountain, being alone and secluded. It's because you become confirmed that you're on the right path towards deathlessness, towards the end of all suffering. It is rejoicing in that Dhamma, that method, that eternally ancient method Because all Buddhas say all the same, is teach the Four Noble Truths, the Noble Eightfold Way, and the 37 States producing enlightenment. They all teach the same skeleton. And the number of Buddhas, Buddha Gautama here has 24 Buddhas. So we know Dipankara was his first teacher. But before there were also three Buddhas in this universe. But before them, there is an endless row of Buddhas. So it's the same method. So to be part of such a tradition that has brought so many millions and billions of beings out of suffering, out of samsara, that is something to rejoice in. That is something to be proud of and to be satisfied with and to find contentment in. Because that is real value. Huh? All the flicker flagger, plima plama out there in the world. Plastic fantastic. Huh? It's nothing. Tomorrow is gone. It's burned, it's ruined, it's scratched. It's impermanent. You cannot trust it. It comes and goes. The entire world comes and goes. Huh? But the Dhamma stays the same. The way out of the prison stays the same. Subtle, refined, complex, sublime, supreme is the Dhamma. Supreme. Nothing comes higher than that. Nothing comes higher than the way to deathlessness. Of course, huh? Can I buy deathlessness for money or for anything else? It doesn't matter whether acknowledging anything or not. It does matter to acknowledge others' support and repay one's debt of gratitude. Acknowledging qualities of a car or of a new film or of an actor or whatever, this, our friend there says, this doesn't matter. But to acknowledge those who have given you birth, that is mother and father, and helped you a lot, and those friends, in particular the spiritual friends, that serve deathlessness on a golden dish right in front of you, sometimes twice a week, that's something that should be acknowledged. Because they keep doing that for free, and you also will come to do that to others. And this, when one gets deathlessness for free, then this is getting the highest for free, then of course this one should feel a deep sense of gratitude towards. Because one cannot get deathlessness anywhere else. One cannot exchange the end of suffering, Nibbana, for money, sex, drugs or rock and roll. One cannot. Huh? One can only get it from a Buddha, or from a Buddhist disciple, and in particular for those who are called nobles, and for one's spiritual friends in general, one's Kalyanamittas, those who have beautiful minds. Towards them, and in particular one's parents, one should feel a deep sense of gratitude, and not, of course, blame them for this and that. It is completely outrageous to do such a thing. So many were the words from our Burmese friend, and the evening are drawing near, and I have to go down to the hydropower and close a nozzle, because there's almost no water left on the mountain. Thank you for your advantageous attention, clever consideration, and kind contribution. and may you indeed also have a nice day. Thank you.
You heard Bhikkhu Samahita from the Cypress Hermitage on the Knuckles Mountain, Pamparela, Central Hill Country, Sri Lanka. Please subscribe to the Google group Buddha Direct and visit the website whatbuddhasaid.net. May all beings become thus happy thereby. Thank you. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Sammasambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the blessed Buddha. Thank you for your contribution, and have a nice day.